Okay, first of all, I also want to thank to the organizers for this opportunity. We are all tired and give a short talk, as short as possible. I will talk about an ongoing work, nearly finished, with my PhD advisor, Professor Altun Spinici from Middle East Technical University. We will talk about a technical issue, actually, a technical issue which you can most probably deal with if you are studying bound states in quantum field theories. So we have some practical need and we are trying to overcome this need. And it turned out to be, well, a problem which is not really complicated, but an exhausting one. So we have to devote some time and some work on it. So most of the talk will be about my motivations, why we need such a calculation, why we need to solve this problem. I won't go into the details of the calculations. I'll just state our results so that I can achieve the goal of my talk. I mean, why we need such expressions. So we will begin with a simple diagram, well, an item from daily life. If you're a theoretical physicist, that's one of your daily life objects, okay, a Feynman diagram. So you see two fermions here and electron positron scattering. Well, it has a certain amplitude. And our objects of interest here are those bilinear structures, okay, Dirac bilinears. So you see the momentum arguments of the spinners are different. So in practice, a particle physicist chooses an explicit representation for the Dirac matrices and for the spinners as well, and calculates the amplitudes by giving reference to those explicit representation. And also it involves an explicit choice of coordinates. So space-time coordinates and your spinner representations are independent objects. You have to choose both of them to specify your spinners and then perform calculations. Well, our motivation was fully out of curiosity. Can we do this calculation without choosing explicit representations and explicit frame of reference, I mean the coordinate system. So another object from daily life, well, this is a daily life object if you are a physicist working on hadrons or, as I said, bound states in quantum field theories. So let me explain the content of this. This is a bound state, for example, a meson state or a hadron state or a baryon state. This is the well-known spectroscopic notation from atomic physics. It is a familiar object. FS refers to Fock states. So, as you know, when we take particle creation and annihilation into account, a bound state is no longer the bound state of a fixed number of particles. For example, a meson is not a bound state of a quark and an antiquark. It is a bound state of quarks and antiquarks, which satisfy the condition that the baryon number of each Fock state is zero. That's the condition on a meson state. So FS refers to Fock states that satisfy the conditions required by this meson state or bound state that you're studying. So we are summing over Fock states in general. This psi, so here are my examples. This guy is famous nowadays. It's called a tetraquark. This can be regarded as a two-particle contribution to positronium, for example. So psi is the corresponding wave function, the wave function that corresponds to the relevant Fock state that you are considering. So you are summing over wave functions, and you are summing over Fock states. What is the meaning of this wave function? Well, we also are familiar with the hydrogenating problem. Think about hydrogenic wave functions. They are wave functions. For positronium, for example, they are two particle wave functions which can be reduced or expressed as if it were a one particle wave function. When you deal with four objects, for example, it's not really easy to calculate the wave function even in quark model or even in non-relativistic approximations. But in principle, we know that they are here, they are present, and we need some ways to calculate these functions. For example, Ercan's remark was important. If you want to calculate the form factors of a hadron, we need the knowledge of these objects. That they encode knowledge on form factors, for example. So you see, when you consider, for example, the positronium, the two-particle contribution to the positronium, you observe some scalar function of momenta times the outer products of spinners. So this is the structure, algebraic structure of this object. So bilinears or outer products, they're equivalent. If you take the trace of this guy, you get a bilinear. So they're equivalent. So we either observe these objects in Feynman diagrams or these ones, mostly when we study bound states, or in the calculation of Feynman diagrams as well. So we want to calculate them in a fully covariant way. I mean, we want to calculate them fully in terms of Lorentz scalars. That's our motivation. So as you see, the problem is not a big problem. I first attempted to solve this problem in 2014 when I was doing my PhD. It was not essential for my thesis. I couldn't solve the problem, and I gave it up to attack at a later time. And I repeated this about four or five times, and I guess at the sixth time, I solved the problem. It's not really difficult, but it's tedious, and it's about our perspective on fundamental objects that we use in quantum field theory. So in quantum field theory books, you see the discussion on these topics, but you don't see any explicit calculation. That was a disturbing observation for me. So our free spinners, well, I will now talk about some relations about vectors and spinners. By vectors and spinners, I mean spinners and the Lorentz vectors, which are their arguments or which are related to those spinners. So our free spinners satisfy the Dirac equation. It is a well-known equation. It is one of the ways to express Dirac equation. So depending on the value of epsilon, plus or minus one, you get a fermion or an anti-fermion solution. And the second one is not really that famous, but it is implicitly used in calculations. This W is the Pauli-Lubanski vector, and this equation gives information about the spin of the particle. So it's not simply it is the spin eigenvalue equation, but not in the non-relativistic sense. So the Pauli-Lubanski vector really carries information on the spin of the particle, but you choose some axis S, which is orthogonal to the momentum of the particle, and the meaning of S becomes clear when you transform, Lorentz transform, to the rest frame. So in the rest frame, it is the spin Z axis. By spin Z, I don't mean an explicit choice of coordinates. Just think of Pauli spinners in non-relativistic quantum mechanics. So a fermion has spin 1 over 2. If you want to solve, for example, the Schrödinger equation, the hydrogenating problem, for example, you have to specify two spin states for the electron, and you choose some quantization axis, most commonly the z-axis, and you perform your calculations. So that's the meaning of this S vector. For a relativistic particle with motion in a reference frame, this S vector does not simply correspond or cannot correspond to the z-axis of your coordinate system. It's something different. So we will motivate our calculation with some observations. Here's the first one. Well, these are our equations. Well, the first change in perspective. Forget about physics. Concentrate on algebra. Okay. This is a problem in linear algebra. You have two equations, and you want to find the eigenvectors. In physics, we are generally interested in eigenvalues. Why? Because eigenvalues correspond to masses in hadron physics, for example, or energies, whatever. But this time we know the eigenvalues. We already know the eigenvalues. We need the eigenvectors. So there are some relations that can easily be proven using these equations and a choice for the phase of our spinners. So this is simply a normalization condition. Well, if you take two positive energy spinners, for example, their contraction with a gamma mu in the middle gives you the momentum of your spinner of your fermion. If the you are taking spinners corresponding to the same spin state, if you sandwich gamma mu gamma 5, you get our S vector. So its meaning is more clear now, I guess. We generally don't make use of this in practice, and I will talk about this issue at the end of the talk. It has a practical value here, okay, so that's why we are using it explicitly. So you can derive similar identities for the negative energy spinners, for V spinners, let me say. There is an interesting observation. There is a combination, a bilinear. So here, I forgot to say, but you guess, I think, the momentum arguments of these spinners are the same. Their momentum argument is P, simply. It corresponds to the same fermion with the same momentum. So if you calculate this combination, for example, U bar plus gamma mu gamma 5, U minus, you observe that it is non-zero. So you can define it as a Lorentz vector. We know that from their transformation properties, this combination is a Lorentz vector. However, this Lorentz vector is interestingly orthogonal to P and orthogonal to S. It is a null vector. You can also calculate its complex conjugate. Well, you have a new object which cannot be expressed by P and S. Why is it interesting? It will be clear in a moment. You observe its further properties. When d slash gamma 5 acts on u plus, it gives you u minus. So this is the spin flip matrix. There are the spin raising young analogs of the spin raising lowering matrices in non-relativistic quantum mechanics. So this observation makes their meaning more clear. Okay. So up to this point, it was interesting. But when we understand this issue, we lose our interest. We understand what they are. But in practice, we are mostly working in 3 plus 1 dimensions. So if you have 4 linearly independent vectors in 4-dimensional space, you can write down any vector in terms of them. You can use these as a basis set to write down any vectors. And a basis set which does not refer to a specific coordinate system is the first step to construct your calculations in a covariant manner. We will call this our P set, referring to the momentum. So P, S, D, and D star constitute a basis to span the entire Minkowskian spacetime. Well, I forgot to write this, but if you think more on the geometrical meaning of these objects, they are nothing but field vines, which you can use which are defined in the space-time position of your particle. So what is the job of a field vine? You take some metric. If you want to convert it into an orthonormal form to study fermions, for example, in a curved background, you need field vines. They are, in a sense, square roots of the metric tensor. So, these P-set objects are a set of field vines. in that sense. So we can write down any vector q by making use of the projections of q on each of these vectors. Well, that's what we mean by writing down a vector in terms of basis vectors. The square of a four vector is basis independent. Well, this implies you can decompose your eta mu, the flat metric, in terms of these basis vectors as outer products of your basis set. That's another interesting observation. Okay, then, well, this is the point where our observations, just out of curiosity, gain their practical value. Okay, so I can consider another sphere with a different momentum argument, corresponding maybe to another particle. Its momentum is q, for example, with eigenvalue m or minus m. Its spin quantization axis, I will say, but you know what I mean. So gamma 5 r slash has eigenvalues plus minus 1. Okay, I can make use of these equations to classify capital U and capital V spheres in the same sense. So we write down the first eigenvalue equation, which is simply our Dirac equation for free spinners, fully in terms of Lorentz scalars. That's nice. Why? If I can calculate the eigenvectors of this matrix, I will achieve my goal. So the problem is really simplified once we understand the geometrical meaning of the vectors we are working with. So we have a second equation here. We can also write it down fully in terms of Lorentz scalars as well. So these equations are eigenvalue equations. That means not all of the equations within them are independent. Actually, for Dirac equation, this guy gives you two independent equations, and this guy gives you two independent equations. So our task is now really simple. We need to calculate the eigenvectors, common eigenvectors of this guy and this one. So in a sense, we take the momentum of a particle and its related vectors as a basis set to span the Minkowskian spacetime, and we take the corresponding spinners as a basis to span the space of spinners. There is one technical issue. These d and d star vectors are not generally referred to in the literature, but they exist there, okay? You can convince yourself that they exist there. For example, if you take some time-like direction as a t-coordinate, if you take a z-coordinate in the rest frame, I mean, to quantize your spin, and these are, this d is x minus iy, and this is x plus iy, okay? They exist there. So this is a technical detail. Well, in such presentations, equations do not mean at all to the people who are not working on the same problem. So I won't try to explain the equations. I only want to emphasize that these equations tell you that you can write down these vectors, d and d star, in terms of p, s, q, and r, in terms of the vectors that are practically used in Feynman diagrams. Okay, here are our solutions. Well, the expressions are not really complicated, but well, if you are trying to solve this problem with pen and paper, they're really tedious to calculate. So we make use of Mathematica at some points to increase the speed of our calculations. But anyway, you can also calculate these by pen and paper only. It's also possible. These are our spinners. So you see, we have written down our spinners purely in terms of Lorentz scalars. Well, at this point, actually, we achieved our goal. Why? Because we can reduce every Dirac bilinear by contractions, I will now explain, into expressions involving the scalar bilinears. Okay? Scalar bilinears, in a sense, form a basis to write down all Dirac bilinears. So this is just, these definitions are for simplicity of the discussion, but I want to use them to emphasize one other fact. We can express everything in terms of four complex functions. Okay. So that's what we expected actually. A spinner in 3+1 dimensions in the irreducible representation, a Dirac spinner, has four components, complex. It means 8 real functions. There are certain identities, certain conditions on the spinners. Okay, so in total, actually, you have 32 real functions. But when you apply these constraints on the spinners, the number reduces to 7. So you observe 7 real functions. This one is real, the other three are complex. Okay, so this is the essence of that expression. And how do we calculate vector, axial vector, or tensor structures of Dirac bilinears? As we said, in 3+1 dimensions, we need 4 linearly independent vectors to write down a Lorentz vector. Well, I have 4 linearly independent vectors. That's my basis. I introduce unknown coefficients, and I contract this expression separately with each of these basis vectors to get the coefficients. A simple freshman level calculation. So for tensor structures, you need, I don't know, a sophomore level knowledge on mathematics, on geometry. So in 3+1 dimensions, all anti-symmetric tensors have 6 independent components. So we need 6 independent outer products. Well, these are 6 independent outer products. And these are certain identities relating the structures among each other. So for tensor and so vector axial vector case, you need 8 calculations. For the other one, you need 4 calculations, and that will be sufficient to write down all others. And these are our results. So you see, we can express, I mean, these are just the coefficients. That's also a technical detail. The slide won't tell much about the problem or the calculations. The only important thing that you can see on those slides is that we achieved the goal to write down any Dirac bilinear fully in terms of Lorentz scalars, and these Lorentz scalars are composed of the momentum vectors of our particles of interest and their spin quantization vectors, or axes. So what is the relation of these vectors to the literature? Well, the second one is mostly used in the literature. We mostly use the helicity basis to define our spinners. But you can define other, you can make other choices as well, satisfying the condition S dot P equals to 0 and R dot Q equals to 0. This is the only condition that you need. And S and R should be normalized to -1. They are space-like vectors. And that's all. If you find such vectors, you can define your spinners as well. So in most quantum field theory books, except Peskin and Schroeder, the method to construct Dirac spinners is the following. You first consider the equation in rest frame. You calculate the rest frame solutions. And then you apply the projection operators on positive energy and negative energy states, and you get the spinners. But while projecting onto, boosting to the moving frame, you don't explicitly state the spin quantization axis. In the rest frame, it's your z-axis, but you don't care about what it becomes when you boost your particle to a moving frame. So this calculation, our work here, just makes this explicit, and you can easily relate the results by choosing a specific basis to calculate your spinners to the expressions that you can see in a quantum field theory. Okay. So as I said, that was a practical need, and after my PhD, I could solve the problem related to this practical need. Here are my references. They are mostly, most of them are books and articles on hadron physics. Okay, thank you for your attention.
Any questions? I know that you